Way to go. Who are these podcasts? WATP.
This is a podcast that's hosted by Tom Myers, Kristen Joseph, Matt Messanoff, and there's a bunch of other people too. It's surprising that there's this many people involved in this show. I'm going to start off. I went back and listened to an older episode. Okay. This was something that Tom actually posted to his Twitter. So Tom's a stand-up comedian. I should talk about Tom Myers real quick.
Yeah.
He's a stand-up comedian. He's out of Maryland. And I believe that he was in the same circles as some of the guys from Cumtown. Okay. I think Nick and Stav were doing stand-up in that Baltimore and Washington, D.C. area. So they crossed paths a few times. And they have documented on Cumtown that Tom Myers is a hack.
Oh, why do you say that, Carl?
He is so unfunny. Fuck it. You know what? I'm just going to go right to his stand-up. Yeah. He has a new special out called Make America Innate Again. Make America Innate Again.
Yeah, all right.
Do you know what the definition of innate is? It makes zero sense. Yeah. This is the title of his stand-up special. He doesn't understand what innate means.
Yeah, I don't think he understands what stand-up means.
No, he does not. He comes out, and this is his first joke when he comes out right out of the gate. It's a penis joke, and it's a real head-scratcher.
Little bit about me. I'm 35 years old, and my girlfriend looks at my penis the same way a kid looks at snow, waiting to hear if school's going to be closed. Anything less than 6 inches, and there's bitter disappointment. And the best case scenario is she gets to go home early.
That doesn't make any sense, Rick.
Does his penis size change from day to day?
Every time his girlfriend looks at his penis, she wants to know what the size of it's going to be.
It's like a penis roulette.
Yes.
Like, reach in there, honey, and who knows what you'll find. It might, you know.
But the best case scenario, she gets to go home early. What is he talking about? So then, right after, that's how he starts his show, with that penis joke.
Wow.
Right after that, he has a fart joke.
Oh, there you go. Yeah, that's now we're talking.
And he does something that any comedian who does this, it's the dumbest thing you could do.
At my age, you're just thankful it's a fart because that means you know that your bowel movements have passed completely. You didn't like that one. This is going to be a long fucking show for you.
I like it when someone's so sure that their joke was great. They're like, well, if you didn't get that one, guys, guess what? It's going to be a tough one. It's like, it was a terrible fart joke.
A fart joke about being 35.
I know. Wow. Whoa,
you
Grandpa.
Know, you know those 35-year-olds, they can't hold their poo anymore. Like,
What's he talking about?
What the fuck?
So,
yeah, that makes as much sense as the jokes he told on this podcast, for sure.
These jokes are atrocious. So I went back and I watched on YouTube a video from PolitiPod in February of 2018, and it's a response to the State of the Union.
Okay.
So these guys are big Trump bashers. Trump had a State of the Union address. And this is Tom Myers, the brilliant comedic stylings of Tom Myers, responding to that.
There was no intro music as the president entered, owing to a disagreement as to what the music should be. The organizers wanted the traditional Hail to the Chief as the president's intro music rather than Trump's suggestions. Bad to the Bone by George Thorogood, or the Classics 4's 1968 hit, Stormy.
Okay, let's unpack that real quick.
All right.
So, Stormy is not a song title that anyone recognizes, right?
He had to give the year an artist.
Right. He's like, by the way, there is a song called Stormy. Yeah. Like, is there? Okay, I guess. And that's a reference to Stormy Daniels. Like, hilarious. That's the song he wanted. But he doesn't even structure the other joke correctly. If you think that Bad to the Bone is a funny punchline, you know what song he wanted to come out to was Bad to the Bone. He says, by George Thorogood. He could have said George Thorogood's Bad to the Bone. You have to place the emphasis on the joke. Like that's how you end the joke.
And why solely George with the punchline. Thorogood's good name
right.
with this joke? Just leave him out of it. Bad to the Bone.
Why would you have a punchline and then more information coming after that? Here's another example of him structuring the joke incorrectly.
When I saw and heard Trump showering praise on General Mattis, I thought, wow, Trump sharing the spot.
Hold on, I gotta start that one over again.
Yeah.
This is a podcast. He could have fixed this. He stumbles over the setup.
Good Lord.
When I saw and heard Trump showering praise on General Mattis, I thought, wow, Trump sharing the spotlight is like the Cookie Monster passing the Oreos. You just don't see it very often.
That is Seamus level humor.
Wow.
Right,
yeah,
there.
That's a little, I'm not even gonna lie, I fucking zoned out. That was a long way to go.
It was not funny in any way, but he also structured it incorrectly. If it is funny to say the Cookie Monster bit, you would say something like, you see that about as often as you see the Cookie Monster passing out Oreos.
There you go.
Right? Because that's the punchline. Like, oh, the Cookie Monster. But you say, yeah, the Cookie Monster passing out Oreos, you don't see that very often. Like, well, yeah. No, I get it.
Yeah.
I get the joke. Yeah. It's
like this guy is... There's that old saying, the problem isn't that people aim too high and miss, it's that they aim too low and hit. And this guy is aiming so low, he's like at Jay Leno's shins. You know what I mean?
Right.
Take the hackiest, just fucking headline of the day comedy, but like, just a little fraction of that and mix in a bunch of garble.
We have a million more examples. Let me just play one more from this State of the Union response. Because listen to how shoehorned this joke is. He is trying to work in the fact that Trump, because of his immigration policy, is going to get rid of Taco Bell.
Mm.
Okay? Alrighty, hilarious promise.
Yeah, I'm on board.
Listen to how he shoehorns in something that makes zero sense.
When the president talked about the four pillars of immigration reform, he didn't mention his treasured fifth pillar. Taco Bell's must go. Unless, of course, they carry the equivalent of his beloved McRib.
All right, so he thinks that the word McRib is funny.
Yeah.
At least he uses it at the end like a punchline.
Yeah, there you go.
But he goes, but what? How does that even make sense? Taco Bell's have to go unless they have something similar to a McRib. What is that? What do you mean? What does that mean?
Yeah.
What are you talking about? It's a taco place.
Yeah.
They wouldn't have a pork sandwich at a taco place. They have tacos.
Yeah.
Fucking moron.
And unless McDonald's has to close unless they serve Whoppers now. Okay, great.
I feel like you're punching up his stuff. Gross. Yeah, really. Why don't you get it on the act here? Get it on some of this fun. What do you got as a clip that maybe sums up the show for you?
Yeah, let me take you back to the beginning. And all right. Look, this clip is long and it sucks. But whatever, dude. That's how else you're going to sum this show up. This was the first bit on the first episode I pulled. This is the generals that support Trump. Here's number one.
These are the generals who don't support
Trump. Don't support Trump.
Right? They denounce Trump.
Yeah, I totally fucked that guy. Holy shit. It'll make no sense now.
He said, the setup to this joke is so long, and then the joke is so terrible. All right, this is bonkers.
We at Politipod are proud to provide you with the top 9 former military officers who will denounce Trump. Number 9, the car insurance general.
Hold on a second.
Just let it play.
Can I just play my setup to that? Because before he does that, he has to set it up with this.
We have heard from the following so far. Condemnations by former Marine General Mad Dog Mattis, by former General and White House Chief of Staff Kelly, former Generals Allen, Hayden, Powell, and Admiral McRaven, former Chairman of the Joint Chiefs of Staff Mullen and Milley, and that's almost an entirely different top 9 list. We at Politipod are proud to provide you with the top 9 former military officers who will denounce Trump.
Okay, so I wanted to play that because this is a political show. These guys fancy themselves as really astute political satirists.
Mm.
So they know all the names and they go through and they explain all the generals who have denounced Trump. And it sets up your amazing clip here, of which is just nonstop hilarious jokes.
We at Politipod are proud to provide you with the top 9 former military officers who will denounce Trump. Number 9, the car insurance general. Number 8, Colonel Sanders. Number 7, Captain America. Number 6, General Mills. Number 5, Colonel Mustard. Number 4, Captain Kangaroo. Number 3, General Malaise. Number 2, Major Tom. And the number 1 former military officer who will denounce Trump is Captain Crunch.
There's a lot of production. There's no good writing, but there's a ton of production. They want to cover it up with production.
They said, here's a list of 9 people who did denounce Trump.
Yeah.
But here's a list of 9 imaginary people that will denounce Trump.
Correct.
Okay.
And right. and the just biggest so punchline was Captain Crunch, although Captain Crunch is just as silly as every other one that they had in there. And also, the reference points are spanning so many decades. Captain Kangaroo?
We'll get to that, Carl.
Captain Kangaroo?
We'll get to that.
Who is this show for?
We'll get to that.
Who would enjoy this?
Oh, excuse me.
I think I just showed you. This guy's like 35. He might be 37 now. Yeah. I don't know when that album came out. He's talking about Captain Kangaroo. That's a punchline?
Oh, it gets worse.
All right, what do you got?
Well, and then he comes out and Tom Myers tells a bunch of, you know, shitty jokes that don't make any sense. There's some of these I put question marks on because I honestly don't get it. Maybe you can explain to me.
Okay.
Carl. Number four.
All right.
A poll was released saying some Americans are financially better off since the pandemic started. What sadist would say they are better off financially during a pandemic besides self-employed people like me?
I had that too because he's so smug. It's such a weird smug thing to say. Oh, people are better off even with this pandemic. I mean, I am. Well, wait a second. First off,
I don't get it.
You're a stand-up comedian.
Yeah.
So you can't do that. Secondly, you have a podcast that's only available on SoundCloud.
I was
and has 75 fucking listens.
I was looking all over for this and I couldn't find it.
I know.
I found it on SoundCloud. I hit play and they're like, yeah, and it's available on SoundCloud.
It's available on SoundCloud where you can see how many people have listened to a show. It's had 75 listens.
Yeah.
I think three of them are from people in this room.
Yeah, seriously.
So 60 people have listened to the show, and yet he's going on there and explaining that the recession hasn't hit him. He's self-employed. How does that even make sense? He talks about it in his stand-up, too. He talks about how great it is to be a comedian.
So I love being a comedian. It's the greatest job in the world. I love it because I get to be my own boss. Every single job I have, I always have bosses that as soon as I get to work, if I show up late, they're always like, Myers, you know you're 5 minutes late for work today? And I go, actually, boss, I'm 23 hours and 55 minutes early for work tomorrow, so fuck you.
That was a math joke.
I have a 12-year-old.
That was a fucking terrible joke.
I have a 12-year-old who tells shitty jokes, and his shit is 100 times better than this. I should have him do a fucking political podcast. He's actually pretty sharp on this.
For some reason, this is the worst podcast because it tries so hard. It's so try-hard that it makes it the worst. We're going to get into a podcast that's hosted by a handicapped person later on, which is terrible, but they're also not trying very hard.
Yeah.
This show is trying so hard, and it's so bad, and the last thing I would do is admit this.
In adopting the moniker, the New American Movement, the president stated that there has never been a better time to start living the American dream. As the head writer of a podcast focusing on lampooning political figures, I could not agree with the president more.
If I was the head writer of Politipod, I'd keep that shit to myself start suing anyone who posts that on the internet.
No fucking kidding.
I'd be having that shit taken down. Holy crap. All right. So I want to get into real quick some of these jokes that I have for this guy going through. Tom Myers.
Yeah.
Goes through and tells a bunch of jokes in a row. In fact, all three of the people have their little parts where they just like bombard you with their political humor.
They do.
And what I did here, Croge, to make it more entertaining for us, is I imagine that Stavros was there with him, laughing along like he does for Nick Mullen.
There you go.
To see if that would maybe make it more entertaining.
Yeah.
Let's find out.
Trump said a protester throwing a rock is just as dangerous as a protester shooting a gun. Not true. Rocks are terrible for use for target shooting and hunting trips. That's precisely why they invented the gun. Militiamen must be very confused. On the one hand, they like that black people are being suppressed. On the other hand, they hate that it's the government-funded police departments trying to do so. Having dealt with the returns policy of several stores, I can understand the desire to want to break windows and burn the business to the ground. Trump says George Floyd is looking down and happy with the way everything is going. Really, Donald? I think he'd much rather be alive.
We already have finals.
Trump probably overheard people in the White House talking about the George Floyd case, didn't understand the context, thought about what he wanted from McDonald's, and decided that everything was okay. The fact that the only black cabinet member, Ben Carson, has been silent throughout the pandemic and the civil unrest just goes to show that the phrase, "it doesn't take a brain surgeon," is now useless.
So bad. It's so fucking bad.
There's a lot of bad jokes in there, but there's one I really want to zoom in on and talk about with you, yeah. Crouch. All right, I'm going to replay it for you, and then let's discuss this at length and nauseum.
Having dealt with the returns policy of several stores, I can understand the desire to want to break windows and burn the business to the ground.
Having dealt with the return policies at several stores, is this a woman that we're listening to? Crouch, have you ever gone to a store and disagree with their return policy? What the fuck's he talking about?
It's never happened a single time in my
life. I bring home something and it doesn't fit? Fuck it, that's my fault. Yeah. That's on me.
Yeah.
I should have tried it on. The return policy. I want to burn boys to the ground because of their return policies. What?
Yeah. Yeah.
That was a man who just said that. A man made a joke about return policies at stores.
Can I play one? Maybe you can explain to me.
Yeah, I'd love to. What do you got?
Here's number six, and I tried hard with this. I cut out zero context. This is the joke from beginning to end. Number six.
People in the South still can't understand why the N-word is offensive. Down there, saying that word is an apology for using an adjective.
There's nothing before or after that. That's
correct.
A fully contained
correct.
Thought.
That's a standalone.
The N-word in the South, because South people are stupid, we covered that, is an apology for using an adjective. I spent some time with this.
Did
dude.
You?
I sat,
it's a riddle.
I diagrammed the sentence out. And
it's a mind
like,
fuck.
Kind of like,
I picture you like a detective where you have like all the elements up on the board and
the
you're trying to draw strings.
Yeah, I'm moving the push button.
All right, there's the N-word. Here's an adjective. Apology. How does this work? There's no way to piece this together.
I don't get it. And look, and you know, to peel back the curtain, I write some jokes, and they're fucking horrible. I submit every Atope show. I submit to Carl the worst fucking list of jokes you ever saw. Thankfully, Carl and Kevin do some work and maybe use a few of them and make them into actual funny shit. But I would be fucking embarrassed if I ever sent this in an email to Carl. I can't even imagine what would come back to me. You know what I mean?
Can I tell you what's even more embarrassing? I think you have this one, too. His Hulk Hogan joke.
Oh, yeah.
Speaking of the N-word.
Wow. What
please.
Is, what is
it? People are going to zone out. Please listen to this entire clip that I'm about to play.
Yeah.
And try to figure out why you would think this is a joke, why you would say it into a microphone, why you would promote this on your Twitter. Please help me understand
this. In the year 2020.
And by the way, I want to point out, Tom Myers has over 6,000 followers on Twitter. He sent out a tweet on June 16th promoting the newest episode of Politipod. There's 3 likes on it. There's 3 likes on a tweet.
Nice.
With a guy with 6,000 followers. All right, here's his Hulk Hogan joke.
Hulk Hogan and his wife were banned from all Elite Wrestling shows after his ex-wife was caught making derogatory comments about Black Lives Matter protesters and a few years after Hulk was caught using the N-word on tape. I imagine Mr. T would love to respond to Hulk Hogan as soon as he finds a crayon. I pity the fool who hid my Crayolas.
So nonsensical. He's talking about Hulk Hogan being banned from wrestling. And then he says, Mr. T is looking for cramps.
It's like free association. Like, what's the first thing you think of, Hulk Hogan? Mr. T, crayons. I mean, how else could you even interpret this as a joke?
I think he just wanted to do his amazing Mr. T impression.
Well, yeah,
I think he was just looking for any excuse.
Yeah.
I do a dynamite Mr. T, and I cannot wait to get it out of my podcast. What did crayons have to do with that?
Yeah. Yeah.
Is that how Mr. T addresses things? By writing them down in crayon? Is this something I don't know about?
Yeah, there's a lot you gotta buy into. Who even knows who the fuck Mr. T is anymore?
I know,
I mean,
right?
That's, wow.
That's fucking crazy.
Yeah.
One more joke from this fucking dumb nuts. Because they're talking about the G7 switching to a video conference instead of an in-person conference.
Yeah, I guess.
Because there's a pandemic.
Yeah.
Crouch.
I heard something about that.
I want to break down the logistics of this joke.
The G7 summit will not happen in one location, but will instead be conducted by video conference. That means there will be no big protests, just someone hacking into the video feed to draw a cock on Trump's face. And when I say a hacker, I mean Angela Merkel. For Politipod, I'm Tom Myers.
All right. Someone's going to hack into their Zoom conference to draw a penis on Trump's face. Does he not know what Zoom is? That's not what people are doing, hacking Zoom. They're actually exposing themselves in other people's Zoom meetings.
Here's hoping, right?
That is You can't go on there and draw on people's faces. This isn't Photoshop. What do they think this is? Am I stupid? I shouldn't have said that. That's going to be clipped.
Yeah.
What does he think? What is he talking about?
An
angle of Merkel.
Angle of Merkel, that is just like a randomest fucking thing.
I swear to God, it's people who think they're savvy when it comes to world politics and just can't wait to show off they know who Angela Merkel is.
He doesn't even know who he is. He just knows it's a name. He should have said Mr. T.
Oh, Mr. T would have been the joke.
And then he could do his impression again. I pity the fool that don't like my penis on
yeah,
his face.
Because Mr. T found his crayon.
Yeah.
So he was able to draw on his face in the Zoom meeting.
Full circle.
Holy shit.
Yeah, I like
it. He should hire us to punch up this show. Seriously. Although I don't think they have any money. Because they're not selling advertising or being listened to by anyone.
Yeah, or publishing their show.
Which brings me to my next point. This show is bizarre. It's all segments. Segments. It's so overproduced, and there's all these segments and music beds and shit. They have a part where they're talking about elections that are coming up.
Yeah. Yeah, like a PSA, like a public, the public access channels. Like
right.
Just a dry reading.
Correct. So this is an example of that. There's no humor here.
Yeah.
But there are political podcasts, and they really do want to get out the vote.
Yeah.
Utah has its statewide primary elections and is strictly vote by mail. And for this election only, ballots can be postmarked the same day as the election. I'm Sarah Savini. Thank you for listening to Election Central with this regional report for the Midwest, the West, and the Pacific region of the United States. Of course, elections happen across America every week. Get registered and go vote.
So,
there's a ton of that.
There's a ton of that.
And it's after 20 minutes of, quote, jokes, unquote.
So they're telling you in Utah, there's an election coming up, but go vote.
Yeah.
76 listens of this podcast in all of the world. How many people are they reaching in Utah, do you think, Crunch?
Yeah. Oh, that's crazy.
How many Utonians? Is that what they're called? Utonians? It doesn't sound right at all.
How many
Utonians?
Yeah. Used to be polygamous, but they had to change it for to be political.
There you go. That's the joke. Right.
It reminded me of, and this is going back away, I think maybe the second or third time you had me over, we listened to a show that was like the Koch Brothers Adventure Hour.
Yes.
Bullshit.
Yeah, yeah.
And it was like just these people trying to prove over and over again how smart they were and how good they were at producing a podcast, but none of it made any sense.
Right.
And I know we had to take that episode down because we performed it in blackface, but if you can get the bootleg copy of it.
I forgot about that part. It made it so much funnier.
Yeah, it really did. But like, so for instance, and I just took a random bit of this long ass bit. If you've ever wondered what the 1921 Tulsa race massacre would sound like if it was personified and a contestant on a game show, here's number 8.
Tulsa race massacre won the coin toss, so let's start with them.
Thank you, Near Bedlam. I think I know how to riot. I use the always reliable, unsubstantiated allegation of assault on white womanhood and caused America's worst racial violence. Second only to our Civil War.
This bit goes on and on and on and on.
I didn't pull anything from that bit because
it
was so stupid.
This is me talking. I'm a fucking asshole. And I was like, I'm not sure you guys are treating this sensitive issue with maybe the care it deserves. And I'm a fucking asshole. You know what I mean?
I know.
Can I play you the most shocking part? There was a part of this podcast that fucking, I couldn't fucking believe it. Number 12.
Okay.
Thank you for having joined us for Politipod. Politipod is a joint effort written by Kayla Avery, Tom Bickle, Dominic DiCecco, William Hamm, Rhonda Hansom, Kristen Joseph, Paul Lander, Tom Myers, Matt Nisanoff, Sarah Savini.
10 fucking writers! 10 fucking writers on this show! Are you fucking kidding me? It took 10 people to put together that?
Yeah, it's about 30 minutes, a little under 30 minutes. It goes from bit to bit to bit. And some of it's actually just serious. Like that game show thing that you played a clip from, I think they were just trying to educate us about how terrible this country used to be back in the 1920s. Like, okay, great. Thanks for that.
Yeah.
Really appreciate it. Wonderful. So wait, people used to be racist and do horrible things. No one else is telling me this information. Yeah. I'm really glad I'm getting this from Politipod.
Yeah. And really honestly, if you're going to tell me that, put a laugh track under it. Because really, when you're studying horrible elements of history, like, you know, All those Holocaust films. Man, if Spielberg would have put a laugh track under that, that would have been a whole different film.
You think that's inappropriate, Croach? You think the laugh track's inappropriate for that type of subject matter? Is that what you're saying?
I'm just saying.
I think you might be right. This is, I listened to the brand new episode, Sullivan Green.
Yeah,
so did you check that out? Okay.
Yeah.
All right, good. I just want to play something for you real quick because this is like some sketch. Well,
it's a self-contained long sketch.
Right.
Where the Trump campaign is kidnapping COVID-19 patients to make them vote for Trump.
Right.
And that's like the overarching thing of this film noir detective story style.
Thank you. Yeah. So this is a joke in the beginning and the middle and the end.
Who is it?
Detective Robert Thorne. NYPD Hypermasculine Protagonist Division.
Hypermasculine Protagonist Division? You mean the NYPD.
Never mind that.
All right, you got a supercut or something of this? Because this was insane.
So, okay, first of all, I just want to say,
everybody follow that joke?
So, Hypermasculine Protagonist Division, that's a joke about storytelling.
Yeah.
And then every reaction is, oh, the NYPD. But it's not a joke about policing, it's a joke about storytelling. So the joke doesn't make sense.
No, it doesn't.
All. So this is every time the joke happens, and it's long and it sucks, and I'm sorry.
Do you think they meant antagonist?
Every time, well, he's leading the story. It's the detective of the film noir, so he's an anti-hero. Try to keep up, Carl. Every time this gag comes up, I increase the speed by 10%.
Okay.
Number 16.
Okay, let's do it.
Who is it?
Detective Robert Thorne, NYPD Hypermasculine Protagonist Division.
Hypermasculine Protagonist Division? You mean the NYPD.
Never mind that.
The Hypermasculine Protagonist Division.
Hypermasculine Protagonist Division? You mean the NYPD.
Never mind that. Hey. Detective Robert Thorne, NYPD Hypermasculine Protagonist Division. Freeze!
NYPD Hypermasculine... The member of the NYPD's Hypermasculine Protagonist Division.
Hypermasculine Protagonist Division? You mean the NYPD?
Never mind that. I'm Detective Robert Thorne, NYPD Hypermasculine Protagonist Division.
Hypermasculine Protagonist Division? You mean the NYPD?
Never mind that. NYPD Hypermasculine Protagonist Division.
Hypermasculine?
Run that gag into the ground, damn you.
So this is a joke that wasn't funny the first time. They do it 5 times.
Oh, my God.
Because it's the rule of fives in comedy. And every time he ends it with, never mind that. Because that's how people talk.
Oh, my God. And so I had that clip. And, like, I clipped them all and I hit play on it.
Yeah.
And I had a mouthful of pills and some vodka. And I'm like, what if I sped this up and I spit a couple of the pills out and poured the booze down the drain? And it's like, it still sucks, but it's...
I tell you, you made the right decision, but I'm not sure.
Also, and I couldn't tell, so part of me was like, well, they're going for a film noir thing, so there's some really fucking dated jokes in here.
Yeah.
But it's all about, like, Trump and COVID-19, so it's very modern day.
Correct.
So I think they're just trying to say, I'm so fucking smart. So here's 13, here's a comp of some super dated jokes.
Is that a lengthy piece of exposition, or are you just happy to see me?
Time Life's Encyclopedia of Seemingly Unconnected Things, Volume 14, Rosebud to Sled.
Citizen Kane.
Now this I could use.
I'm a New Yorker. We walk everywhere. Even Franklin Roosevelt, after he had polio.
Jesus Christ.
FDR, Citizen Kane, and Mae West? Like, what? And again, like, maybe I'll give them a little bit of credit and say they were trying to give the smoky 40s movie.
No, because I played the example before. We were talking about Captain Kangaroo.
Yeah, it's...
This is what happens when people listen to NPR for too long. They think they're smart. They've heard people whisper to them about the news. They think they're smart now. Now they start spouting out everything they've learned. Did you know that in 1921 in Tulsa, there was a... Who gives a shit? Shut the fuck up.
Insufferable. Totally.
Shut the fuck up. And then in this skit they do, they have a guy doing a Trump impression.
It's the worst I've ever.
And guess what the joke is? Trump's stupid.
Whoa.
Watch this. He can't read really well.
Is CIDIC CDC? Is that a typo? It projects that we should only lose 34% of the country by the time this goes away.
All right. More Trump. This is a joke that... And again, they use the rule of threes wrong. Like, these people are so bad at jokes, they don't even structure the joke. Even if it was witty and funny or interesting, they would fuck it up because they don't even know how to structure jokes correctly.
Yeah. We're doing an incredible job. Tremendous. Isn't that right, Dr. Quinn, medicine woman?
It's Burks, Mr. President.
What? It's Burks? That's disgusting. But it's a medical term, I guess. All these doctors have been coming up to me and saying, how do you know so much about this stuff? You know all the terms. Spurks, band-aids, terminal syphilis.
Excuse me, Mr. President, the announcement?
Right, right.
I mean, and I am a terrible singer, and I'm very upfront about that. But this isn't even in the right register. Like, it's not even in close to the key. You know what I mean? Trump has a very...
Right.
There's the notes that he uses when he's speaking is very... I don't know. It's very unique. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah.
This guy's not even close. He's not even in the neighborhood. You know what I mean?
So he goes, people are really impressed with all the medical terms I know. And they're trying to get you this joke of terminal syphilis. Right? That's the funny punchline. But the gag before that in the list of threes is Band-Aid. So they want everything to be a joke, but nothing's a joke.
Yeah,
like they think everything's a joke, and yet nothing in this show is a joke.
Yeah,
nothing is mildly amusing or humorous. It just makes you angry, and it reminds me of the kids in school who were in like drama club, and they all thought they were funny, and they all made each other giggle and laugh, and everyone else looked at them like, "You guys are fucking nerds. What are you guys doing?
Yeah,
you're not witty or interesting.
Yeah.
Get off the stage." I don't want to see you on the stage anymore.
This was unbearable.
All right, so one more thing on the Trump thing.
I had no fun. Go ahead.
So you know that Trump said, let's all ingest Lysol, whatever the fuck people say he said. So they take it one step further. Because, you know, the coronavirus, it looks like a cat toy.
Ooh.
You know how they show that coronavirus like a ball with like the things on it?
Scary graphic.
Last week, I signed and read part of the order enforcing the national distribution of Clorox chewables and kicked off the feline ingestion program.
Just a gentle reminder to everyone, please don't eat live cats.
Don't listen to her. The virus looks like a cat toy. Everybody knows it. So it's obvious the best way to bat it out of your lungs is to send a kitty or two down there. I know an old lady who swallowed a cat. She was fine with it.
If this was a 2.5 second joke, maybe I'd let it slide. But
I would let all of these jokes slide if it was a one-off and other things around it were good.
Yeah.
Because you're not going to hit every time.
So please.
But to miss every single time like this is shocking. Go ahead.
Well, and don't even play this. But so there's a joke where he's like, I saw these doctors with charts. They should play instruments because musicians play charts. But they stretched this out. This was a 3.5 paragraph joke that they explain over and over again. It's like, I can't wait to never hear any of this ever again. This was unfucking bad.
You don't want to play that clip? I see that you have it here.
No, I'll fucking.
It's funny because.
I'll fucking puke on you.
It's funny because, Crows, you and I.
Full Pennywise. It's Fletcher time in this motherfucker.
You and I play in bands. We've had horn sections. We know about charts.
Yeah.
And yet, it wasn't funny. And then they had to explain it to people who wouldn't know about charts and made it even less funny. Do you know why I'm so clever? Because this is what I just did.
Did you know there's multiple definitions for a single word? And I kind of skewed the line between those two definitions. Isn't that great?
Holy shit. All right. Let's get into more of their hilarious commentary on politics. And of course, they go after the Republicans and they get those Republicans good.
The Republicans decided to move their convention from North Carolina. Congratulations to the new host, the Kremlin.
Whoa, you got butt slammed!
Wow, they sure got their number.
Sophisticated humor.
Sophisticated humor.
Yeah.
You know what? You know who else is going to get butt slammed? It's Trump. I don't know if you know this, Grosh, but the billionaire is now our president.
Yeah.
Wasn't really good in school.
When Trump heard it was D-Day, he thought they were celebrating his college grades.
Whoa!
Wow.
Take that, Trump.
Wow.
I don't know if he'll ever recover.
Oh, man.
He thought D-Day was celebrating his grades.
Oh,
come the fuck on.
Dude,
you did not just say that on a podcast.
You're not going to believe this? Seamus sent them a tweet and said, spice up those jokes.
Yeah. Seamus, like, can you punch it up a little bit next time? Those jokes are fucking terrible.
Holy shit.
All right, I want to talk about another bit they did, and this is about Father's Day.
Yeah.
So the stage here, and what you're going to be hearing, is Jared Kushner is talking to Ivanka. Yeah. And they're talking about, what are we going to get for Trump for Father's Day? And it's bizarre that this was scripted. And all of this show is scripted.
Yeah.
It's bizarre this was scripted because it sounds like one of the characters is not even listening to the other character.
Yeah.
Which happens on podcasts.
Yeah.
People just aren't listening. They're not paying attention and they just start talking. Like, what? I don't think you heard what that person said.
Well, anyway, Chris, what I was saying about...
But was written down.
Yeah.
And they still have no idea what they're talking about.
I just don't know what to get Dad for Father's Day. He's been so generous with all these new responsibilities. I need to make it a good one.
Oh, Daddy only deserves the best.
Maybe I could get him something special to thank him for letting me run his re-election campaign, in addition to my other undeserved positions.
That could work.
I should get him something special. That could work. What does that mean? He didn't explain what he was going to get for him.
It sounds like they write these with those fridge magnets.
Yes! You know what I mean? Right, like, what word do you got? But again, what they're trying to do is they're trying to show their know-how.
Yeah.
And, you know, Jared Kushner's been given a lot of responsibilities lately. Let's write a skit around that.
Well, that voice impression was impeccable. You gotta,
dude.
Sounds just like him.
I had no idea who it was supposed to be at first. I'm like, is this Don Jr.? Like, what are they talking about? Yeah. And then it's like, okay, it's Jared Kushner. This is the exciting conclusion to that sketch, which is nonsense. And this conclusion is bonkers.
Now, where were we?
Well, you were thinking we could get Dad.
Did I hear you talking about Father's Day?
What? Baron.
Baron? Where did you come from?
I've been here since last Thursday. Dad dropped me off because he said I was in the way. And Mom didn't care. Do you?
Last Thursday? What?
Anyways, so what are we getting Dad for Father's Day?
That's a real head scratcher there. So the joke was, Baron's been there the whole time.
Yeah, there you go.
Last Thursday?
Yeah, that's a strong one to end on.
What the fuck are they talking about?
This shit's not even in the neighborhood of comedy. You know what I mean?
It's not as if they're going to figure it out. Yeah. You know, you hear those shows, you're like, it's got potential. Yeah. They'll figure it out. No, they're not even sure how to structure a joke or what makes jokes funny.
They have
no understanding of that. By the way, Crouch, I was thinking this Tom Myers character.
Yeah.
Which is, I can't believe this guy calls himself a comedian and he's so smug about how he's a comedian, what a great job he has. Can we do a bonus show where we break down Make America a Nate again?
Like we did with Vic Henley? You just want him to pass away early.
Fine, whatever.
Yeah, I'm in.
If I have that type of power, then I'm going to use it.
Hey, use the WATP curse for good, not evil.
Correct. All right, so there's this other woman, Kristen Joseph. And I want everyone to know that each of the comedians on this show are at the exact same level.
Yeah.
The jokes are almost ubiquitous. You can't tell who wrote the joke.
They all found each other at the bottom of the barrel. That's
they did. Sure. All right, so here is the Pope joke that I wrote down. And God, this just like reminds me of Samantha Bee. I don't know if you ever watched Samantha Bee. I don't. But whenever I see clips from her show, it's always this joke where if you're all in on the fact that Trump is the biggest racist and dumbest idiot to ever exist, like if that's your premise going into it, then these jokes work on top of that. But you have to be all in on like these ridiculous premises and then you can say the stupidest shit and get a reaction out of people. Here's an example.
When Trump heard that Pope Francis supports the Black Lives Matter movement, he was confused. He usually agrees with white men who wear pointy white hats.
Yeah. There you go. That's a that's a hell of a string to string, but yeah.
Yeah, yeah. All right. Well, let's hear her. Let's hear a number of her terrible jokes in a row here. Let's see what's going on.
Megyn Kelly's mad. HBO lifted Gone with the Wind from its streaming platform. Frankly, Megan, nobody gives a damn.
Nope.
We're waiting to hear Kellyanne Conway say it wasn't tear gas. It was alternative crying spray.
Nope.
Lindsey Graham dyed his hair blonde, so Trump will love him as much as he loves Ivanka. Trump asked Stephen Miller to write a speech on race relations, which is like asking Ted Cruz to write a speech on charisma.
Fucking thing sucks!
Thank you, Mr. O'Reilly.
This is what this show is. That clip that we just played, it's just nonstop one-liners that are not funny or witty or interesting. Yeah. And then, I mean, they go after Trump a lot, but Croge, this is a real zinger.
Trump is leaving the White House basement to go golfing again. So, from one bunker to another.
Sit first!
Whoa, I guess he's not very good at golf. He's in the bunkers. Get it, Croge? This guy sucks as a president, and he's not even very good at golf. Whoa. Yeah. If Opie was on the show, he'd be like, damn. What a sick bird. And Tucker Carlson, he's not going to escape unscathed. I can tell you that.
Tucker Carlson is what happens when William F. Buckley fucks a potato and send it to boarding school for 12 years.
That's terrific. That's terrific. When William F. Buckley.
William F.
You
Buckley.
You can Google that.
William F. Buckley.
Fucks a potato, number two. And number three sends it to boarding school, the potato that he fucked for 12 years.
This is the 50s? The fuck is he talking about?
Yeah, he's been dead since like this, huh? Yeah, I mean.
It's fucking, wow. I don't know who this show is for. It's not for me. It's not for me.
I can't wait to never listen to it again, Carl.
Yeah, but we do have to listen to Tom Myers stand up now.
Yes.
It's all on YouTube, too. I don't think give him $10 like I did to Vic Henley. Croge, thanks for coming over tonight.
Oh, thanks for having me.
Feels like you were just here. We were talking about Politipod.
Yeah.
Politipod starring Tom Myers, comedian. Myers.
And what a pod that was.
That was fantastic. And it led us down the rabbit hole that is Tom Myers comedy.
Yeah. Well, I mean, if we learned anything from reviewing his show, it's that he has a really good sense of humor about things.
Yes. He doesn't take himself too seriously, which is nice.
Yeah.
And he writes really good jokes.
Mm.
Croge, we listened to Make America Innate Again.
Did we ever?
Which is his new CD, or his newest CD. I think he recorded it in 2018.
Yeah.
And he promotes it, and he wants to sell it to you. You can buy it off of his website, or you can just listen to it on YouTube.
Well, yeah,
the entire thing for free, which is what we did.
And I know you brought this up already. What do you think he thinks innate means?
Yeah, what does he think innate means?
I was trying to figure that out. Like, was he going for inert or like, you know what I mean? Like he was going for dumb or something, but that's innate means like in, you know, inbred knowledge or whatever. It's,
right.
It's a totally different, doesn't make any fucking sense.
Doesn't make any sense. It just rhymes with great.
Yeah.
But not even in a good way because it's not the same number of syllables.
Yeah, yeah.
It's really bad all around. But I want to tell you, Croge, I don't know if you know this. He had a different title for this album before it became Make America Innate Again.
Is that so?
Yeah, he was on ABC2 on the midday news in Baltimore.
He was arrested for something?
Doing an interview.
Oh, okay.
So, you know, like these local news programs, they have to do the 6 a.m. to 9 a.m. They have to do the noon, the midday, the 5 o'clock, the 6 o'clock, the 11 o'clock. There's
14 hours a day to fill.
14 hours a day of local news to fill. So the midday show needs a lot to fill it up.
Oh,
so they had Tom Myers on to promote this album. And this is an interesting piece of information.
Actually, the original title of that CD was supposed to be Sit Down and Shut Up, You Morons.
Yeah.
But people thought that was a
little
much.
Aggressive.
Yeah. Telling someone to sit down is a bit too strong.
That poor news anchor. Yeah. She didn't know how to respond to that. She goes, okay.
Like 10 years ago, David Cross already had an album called Shut Up, You Fucking Baby. I mean, this has already been done.
Sit down and shut up, you morons.
What the fuck?
The fact that this guy would call anyone a moron is insane. Croge, let's get into it.
Yes.
I know you got a bunch of clips. I have a bunch of clips. You have one that sums up his stand-up comedy for you?
I do, and it's his opening bit, number one, the first joke.
A lot of comedians, they have an expression. Whenever they do well, they say, oh, I killed it, man. I killed the room. I killed it. I think with the number of people in this room and the amount of time I'm able to do tonight, I think I may have time to individually strangle every single person in this room.
Bro, if that's the laugh your opening joke gets, thank you. Good night. thanks for coming out. It's been you've been a great audience.
Yeah, totally downhill from there.
Right back behind the curtain, this guy should have been, because that was fucking brutal.
People were being polite, though.
And what kind of joke is that? Like, of all the jokes about jokes and comedy about comedy, like, hey, they say you kill, I'm going to kill everybody. Like, get it? Because kill means get it? Isn't that great?
I think that what I have to address right off the bat here, it's very important.
Yeah.
He has a joke that he's famous for.
Really?
On the internet.
Really?
It's not in the Make America Innate Again. It's from an earlier special. I checked him out on this thing called the Ed Schrader Show. Do you watch this video?
You liked him before he was cool, is what you're telling
me? No. I am just getting hip to this shit now. Somebody posted in our Discord. By the way, on our Discord, we now have a Tom Myers channel.
Oh, great.
I know.
I can't wait to get in there.
Which That's I'm very excited great. About. And somebody posted a video, I think it was from like 2009 or something. He was on a show called The Ed Schrader Show. And he gets up and he does his style of stand-up comedy.
Mm.
And it starts with this bit, which he is now famous for. If you go to any video on YouTube featuring Tom Myers, there will be about 8 or 9 comments that feature this bit.
Yeah, I'm in kind of a weird mood myself. I was on my way down here. I stopped at a convenience store. I'm waiting in line to pay, and the guy in front of me puts down 12 donuts, 2 big bags of Doritos, one of those cheapo 1-gallon bottles of the generic brand fruit punch, and a nasty, old, rotting banana. And he turns to the clerk and says to him, "My girlfriend just had an operation. She can only eat certain things." I look at him, and I go, "Yeah, right. What, did she have a bong hit transplant?"
So this is what sums up this guy's comedy.
Holy fuck.
The bong hit transplant bit sums up his comedy.
And that reaction just nails it. I mean, that's holy shit.
This was his first joke on this TV show. Yeah. And I have isolated just the punchline and the reaction. Because the buildup of, at first, it's utter silence. Like, wait, what did he say? Like, it doesn't make any sense. Yeah. Nobody knows what he's talking about.
Yeah.
And then as they realize that was the punchline, and they start to piece together how stupid he is, you hear people start to go like, whoa, holy shit. Like they're witnessing something that will live on in infamy.
"What, did she have a bong hit transplant?"
Whoa.
If that ever happens to you, you get that reaction from your opening joke, it's time to quit comedy.
Yeah, yeah.
Let's get back to Make America Innate Again. He covers a lot of different topics.
Boy, does he
ever.
This is
about a 36-minute-long stand-up special.
Yeah. And if I was going to give him credit for anything,
yep,
it's that he keeps it moving.
He does.
He keeps it moving.
He plows through. Do you have another joke that you wanted to highlight?
You know, I do. And this was the reason I want to play this one is because it's like you can see this joke coming, but like on a tricycle with like one busted wheel, and it just takes forever to get to your number two.
One piece of advice I give for comedians, if you get the chance to perform at senior citizen centers and old folks' homes, do it. Please do it. I mean, it's a great experience. You can fart on stage and no one will suspect it's you. And if you forget your jokes, you can go ahead and do the same ones again, and they won't know the difference.
A fucking Alzheimer's joke. Like, dude, you're selling a CD, and you've got a fart joke followed by an Alzheimer's joke? I mean, that's, you know, middle schoolers are like, dude, you gotta bring it up a notch here. Yeah. What the fuck? What are we doing here?
Yeah. It is funny how many jokes he has that are either dick jokes or fart jokes. What I really like, though, is when he starts doing impressions.
Oh, yeah. He has some great impressions.
He has some really good impressions. And what should we start with? Samuel L. Jackson?
Yes. Let's do it.
Yeah. So the setup here is I need a new GPS voice. You know, the GPS voice that I have is just not cutting it for me. I travel a lot. So I need Samuel L. Jackson. It's so cliche, dude. It's like an 80s comedian. I wonder what it would be like if Samuel L. Jackson was the GPS voice.
And I promise you, that was a Facebook mom's meme like 5 years ago. This isn't even like an original thing. That's like one of those Minions jokes that your wine aunt passes around.
I bet it would sound a little something like this.
I am sick of all these motherfucking cars on this motherfucking highway. I want the Samuel L. Jackson GPS voice because my GPS is currently stuck in Paul Walker mode. I'm sick of it.
Do you hear that guy? He goes, hey-o. When you can hear each individual reaction, they're not even shouting. They're just talking, and you can hear everyone in the crowd. Someone's like, hey-o, Paul Walker.
And I wanted to bring up what room this is, because it's like, it's not even a half-full coffee shop. I mean, it's not even Vic's open mic night.
It's not even the studio right now.
Yeah, seriously.
People sitting in the studio right now. After that, he does a George W. Bush impression.
Does he ever?
This one is pretty spot on. And this is talking about George W. Bush on cocaine.
Of course.
So you're going to hear him sniffing a line first. You go, of course. Oh, that hack, bitch. Well,
I mean, normally when you talk about George W. Bush, you talk about him on cocaine. That's just
fair enough. All right, let's see what he's up to.
Hey, everybody. Got a great idea. Let's fuck with the Middle East.
So, you used to be able to get away with just having a good impression and no material.
Yeah.
Like, there were a lot of guys who just did the voices well, and it didn't matter what they said. People were like, oh, wow, he does those voices really well. And then it got to the point where even if you could do the voice well, you had to have material. You had to have it make it funny. Like, what's the premise? Why is this unique or interesting?
Yeah.
This guy can't do the voice well and has no material.
That's unbelievable.
2018.
Why would you do that?
Why would you do that?
And then he combines, and you know how much I love this, Carl, comedians who sing on stage.
Yeah.
Combined with the joke that takes a fucking half an hour to roll down the fucking bottle into the cup.
Oh, God.
And he does a Stevie Wonder.
Stevie Wonder. This is the worst one of all.
And I left it in like the intro because, man, the setup to this fucking snowball of fucking piss is just awful.
You know who I really feel bad for? I really feel bad for Stevie Wonder because he can never pull off a cover of Amazing Grace. I once was lost, but now am found. Was blind, but now shit.
Who did not know where he was going with that?
And that's the thing, like, why would you take so long to do that? Like, dude, as soon as you said, okay, we get it. Yeah, I can't see. What?
Honestly, the joke might have been decent if he just said Stevie Wonder could never sing Amazing Grace. And you could connect it in your head and be like, oh, right, I get it. Everyone knows the lyrics.
And dude, and not to go on, but in the year of our Lord, 2018, this guy's telling Stevie Wonder's blind jokes? I mean, what the fuck?
Well, I
guess they were originally Ray Charles jokes, but he updated them for a modern audience. You know what I mean?
So when he's on this Ed Schrader show, we're going back to 2009, as I mentioned. Maybe it's 2008. He's talking about the election. It's an election year.
Yeah.
And at this time, we still didn't know who the Democratic nominee was going to be, whether it was going to be Barack Obama or Hillary Clinton. We take you back in the Wayback Machine, Carl. Remember this?
Yeah, exciting times.
Exciting times. So he's got a joke for that, talking about who he would like out of Hillary or Obama.
Me, I'm an Obama person, but me, I kind of, part of me kind of wants Hillary Clinton to take the Oval Office. Woo! No, okay, hear me out. What's the first thing Hillary Clinton's going to do when she gets in office? Get back at Bill for all the shit he pulled. That's why I'm going to apply to be an intern.
Yes.
What the fuck?
The fucking reaction to that. So the premise is, I want to go down on Hillary Clinton. Which, by the way, nobody wants to do that.
I don't know.
I don't know why that would be something you'd be interested in doing, but that's the premise, right? Yeah. I want to go down to Hillary Clinton. And the reaction, I just want to play this for you again. Listen to the reaction people have. They're so disgusted by this.
I'm going to apply to be an intern.
The woman goes, what? But guess what, Crouch? It gets better. There's a tag. And he doesn't do this often, but sometimes he puts tags out of his jokes. And he's got a tag on this Hillary Clinton joke, which, by the way, flopped. And you might want to just not tag it. If you have a joke that nobody laughs at, people like visibly go, and yeah. What?
Just
move on. What else you got?
On to the next
thing. No, he's got a tag for it.
I quit smoking, though, so I don't know if that'll affect my shot, but.
Yeah, all right. Carlos, let me break this down for you, because he looked confused. What he's saying is
now, that a
Bill Clinton shoved a cigar in Monica Lewinsky's
pussy.
Is
that a cigar in the vagina?
Let me bring it back to 1998.
Yeah.
All right, there was a cigar that went into a vagina.
Man.
This guy goes, I want to go down on Hillary, but I quit smoking, so I'm not sure if she'll let me.
Yeah, the leaps you got to make to even get that.
And as you hear people's reaction, they're just like, she's a lesbian. That's what one guy yelled out.
Yeah.
I don't know if you can hear that.
Yeah.
People were just like, no.
Well,
that's ridiculous.
I don't know if you want to start talking about this. In his newest special, he does talk about a lot of public figures.
Yeah.
Including another brilliant, hop across the lily pad joke with Hillary Clinton, number 20.
All right.
But of course, people are upset about the Trump presidency. They say, oh, Hillary Clinton should have won. Hillary would have been a much better president. You know, she had the experience. She was a former first lady. She was a United States senator. She was secretary of state. She's well respected all over the world. That doesn't have anything to do with it. Ted Kaczynski was great at wrapping Christmas presents. You just didn't want him to get your name in the annual Christmas gift exchange.
And that's the joke.
I know. It
and
doesn't
that,
go any further
those
than that.
Three groans are what you get. So Hillary is the Unabomber, I guess. I mean, I was like, I put that clip and I listened to it and I'm like, I listened to it again. I'm like, well, is he? I mean, what is the.
Can I ask you a question about this?
Skill set, but trying to say like.
Yeah. Just because you're good at that doesn't mean you wouldn't use it for evil.
But like the Unabomber like maimed people. Like he blew people's shit up, dude.
But let me ask you this, and I could be wrong about this because I don't study Ted Kaczynski as much as I should.
Yeah, we all should.
Did he send bombs in the mail at Christmas time?
I don't think he discriminated. I think
did it have anything to do with Christmas?
Here's the thing about Ted Kaczynski.
Yeah.
Every day was Christmas.
Right.
For Ted Kaczynski. I mean,
I hope I'm not wrong about this, but I feel like the premise is flawed.
When you got a shack in Montana packed with explosives, like every day is a party. You know what I mean?
I feel as though his premise is flawed. He's like, it's like the Unabomber on Christmas. You're like, well, all right, now you've gone three leaps because none of this makes sense.
And he doesn't even say Unabomber.
Oh,
and
no,
the
right.
guy's been in jail for 15 years.
He's been
in jail for 15 years. I mean, who's even following this? Other than you and me and all these, you know, who the fuck is even following this?
Oh, it's fucking funny.
I mean, can we go through more of these public figures that he talks about?
Please.
Number 16.
Read an interview with the billionaire financier Warren Buffett. He's supposedly like the second wealthiest man in America. In this interview, he admits that he drinks 5 cans of Coca-Cola a day. 5 cans of Coca-Cola a day. That means if he ever eats an entire packet of Mentos, his head's gonna skyrocket higher than his fucking net worth.
Whoa, slow down, egghead.
All right.
Now, it's Diet Coke, right?
It is Diet Coke with Mentos.
Okay, so it's
right.
Not even...
Coca-Cola is not a thing with Mentos.
Yeah, he doesn't even have the right thing. And then, because he combined Warren Buffett with Mentos with net worth, I mean, like, the fuck kind of joke is that?
Well, the worst part about that joke is it's going to fly higher than his net worth because he's trying to think of, well, he's really rich and then why would that be? Oh, this is the funny joke.
And he gets the right reaction. Just, I mean, what are these people held hostage? Is he in a mental institution? Is this like the food court in the mall? Like, I mean, how did he fucking record this? He's in front of the Taco Bell.
I picture a Clockwork Orange where the eyes are just pulled open,
fucking strapped into the chairs. Yeah,
they've watched his act 18 times in a row. This is the 19th time. That's when he recorded it. You will obey. You will obey. You will obey. You will laugh. You will laugh. All right.
There's an amazing Bill O'Reilly reference.
Oh,
17.
Okay. Let's do that.
And Bill O'Reilly came out recently and said that he blames his firing from Fox on those who lean to the left. That's very fascinating. I didn't know Bill O'Reilly's penis leaned to the left.
I sounded kind of camp, too, when I said that. I didn't know his penis leaned to the left. Hello?
Fucking thing sucks!
Seriously, what's he doing?
The fuck, dude? All right, man.
He blamed it on... Did he say he blamed it on people who leaned to the left?
Wait, I think you're looking.
Hold on a second.
He did. Don't bother. It's awful. It's not even supposed to make sense. All right. You guys like talking about preteens masturbating? I sure do. Here's number 19.
Yeah. I have this clip too.
He has a 10-year-old son now, which means he's going to be a teenager pretty soon. That'll be an historic moment. Barron Trump will be the first teenage son of a sitting United States president to masturbate to internet porn.
That laugh says, I'm not allowed within 25 miles of an elementary school. Dude, who is like, hey, 10-year-old kid, masturbation joke? Like, no, well,
let me stop you right there, Croge. Where's the joke? What's the joke? When is the joke?
Well, the joke, Carl, is that he masturbates because he's a child. And that's what, you know, naturally you think of.
When he's a teenager, he will be the first teenager to jerk off to internet porn. There's no witty observation. There's no angle that he takes on it. Just teenagers masturbate to internet porn. And I just have to ask, what's the joke?
And he's not even a teenager yet. He prefaced the whole joke with 10-year-old kid. That's the fucking creepiest fucking part. Even if he just said kid or like what or teen or whatever. You know what I mean?
Can I point out?
What the fuck?
Can I point out?
Even I'm grossed out by that. I'm a fucking creep. I mean, what the fuck are we doing here?
You're actually my creep next week on the Creep Off.
That's what I'm saying.
The category is WATP co-hosts. Vinny's got Doug from Who's Right. I got crushed.
Oh, I'm a shoo-in.
Yeah, no shit. So that thing where he started giggling about it, like he's a predator, as you mentioned.
Yeah, like Chris Hansen's on the other line.
He does this a lot. Mm. When he doesn't get a reaction from people, he laughs at his own joke. He's heard these jokes before. It's not funny to him. It wouldn't be anyway. What am I talking about?
Yeah.
But this is him screwing up and then doing his nervous laughter. So you could tell this is just a tic that he has.
One piece of advice I give for... One piece of advice I give for comedians...
My takeaway from this is I understand the nervousness of this. I would never be able to get up in front of people and deliver this material.
Oh, my God.
I would be sweating buckets. I'd be so nervous to deliver these jokes, especially as they keep going over. They're just flops.
Yeah.
Every single one worse than the one before it. And he just keeps pushing through. Like you said, he doesn't slow down. He doesn't stop. He doesn't get a quiver in his voice. He's got that nervous laughter thing going.
Yeah.
But I give him credit. And actually, while I'm giving him credit, there is one joke that I thought was pretty good. And it's the only decent joke he has in the entire thing.
I dated this one girl who was into fantasy and role playing. Yeah, she dressed up and pretended she was a Catholic schoolgirl. And I pretended that I loved her.
I could see I could see that working into a Dave Attell act. It would be delivered a lot better.
Yeah.
It would be sandwiched with a bunch of other funny jokes. But at least he had one joke that I'm like, all right, you actually executed on something.
Yeah.
You actually threw us for a little bit of a loop. Which, by the way, every other joke is so obvious. And I want to point this out about his stand-up, just his style in general.
Mm-hmm.
It's so linear. He has no rhythm as a comedian.
Yeah.
It's very much just a blah, 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 setup, 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 blah, 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 punchline.
Yeah.
Blah, 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 setup, 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 blah, 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 punchline. And they're rarely connected. Like, you think about, like,
it's
Jim Gaffigan or something. Like, let's talk about bacon for 5 minutes.
Yeah.
And it makes it funny because you're like, holy shit, he's still talking about bacon. You know, it's funnier.
He's building something. He's giving you a whole world where all these jokes are coming from.
Right.
Where this guy just has Mad Libs, where it's like, oh, here's, you know, insert this, and then Bill Clinton, da-da-da-da-da, blowjob. Hey, isn't that great? You're like, well, okay.
So this brings me to going back to ABC2 and the Midday News. She asks him why he started doing stand-up comedy.
Yeah.
And he says this.
Yep.
So...
tell us a little bit about yourself. You said you started with comedy as almost a defense mechanism?
Yeah, it was in high school. I started telling jokes to upperclassmen to sort of deflect being bullied. Ah. People often ask me, you know, what's the toughest room I ever worked? I say the men's locker room at Falston High School. The whole comic book series, Kill yes. or Be Killed, I yes. lived it.
Oh, my goodness.
That was her first question. Way to have fun with it, asshole.
Yeah, wow.
So tell me, funny guy, why do you do comedy? I was bullied as a child. Like, so anything else in the news? I got anything fun coming up this weekend? All right. So then after that, she says, well, you do jokes that people find offensive and you get in trouble for these jokes. Why do you keep doing them? And listen to who he compares himself to. This is fascinating. Let's jump into the mind of Tom Myers.
Yeah.
I don't know if there were pre-interview questions. I don't know if he was ready for this, but this is a shocking answer, whether it's off the cuff or he prepared for it.
Some of your jokes, though, have gotten you into a little bit of trouble.
Right.
So why keep telling them?
Because it's my job. You know, it's no different than, you know, a police officer running to the scene of a crime or a firefighter running into a burning building. It's what I do.
Jesus fucking Christ. Listen, I don't use the word hero lightly, but by me telling jokes about your sister's twat, I'm obviously a fucking hero.
Yeah. You know that guy who killed Osama bin Laden? Well, you know what I do is I talk about Barry Trump masturbating.
Yeah,
we're the same
exactly.
person. Can't you tell? Guess what, Crozier? It gets worse.
Oh,
he continues to explain why he continues to tell jokes people find offensive. Listen to the people he compares himself to.
Oh,
this is
no.
insane.
It's what I do. You know, Mort Saul was blacklisted by Hollywood because
you.
he kept talking about the Warren Commission report on stage. Lenny Bruce kept
you
having obscenity trial after obscenity trial.
You son of a
George
bitch.
Carlin,
George Carlin,
one of his bits,
you.
Was taken
Are
to the United States
me?
Supreme Court.
Wow.
So, you know, I'm not really doing anything, not doing anything different.
You have to be fucking kidding me.
He's no different than Lenny Bruce and George Carlin.
Lenny Bruce and George Carlin.
This guy's so delusional.
Are you out of your fucking mind?
He's out
You're
of his mind.
You're telling fart jokes in a coffee house. George Carlin presented his arguments in front of the United States Supreme Court.
Right.
He defended the First Amendment for you and me
Correct.
To sit here and talk like assholes.
Correct.
This guy is fucking telling little kids masturbate jokes. And he's a fool. Oh, I can't fucking take it, dude.
Dude, how funny
that
is that?
That was intense.
How funny
that
is that?
That was fucking intense.
This justifies everything that we have to say about Tom Myers. The fact that he's out there comparing himself to Lenny Bruce and George Carlin.
We're not even, we haven't even begun. We were only getting started, dude. I was having fun until now.
I saw what it turned. I can see the look in your eye. You are no longer having fun. Nor
By
should
way,
you be. We're listening to Tom Myers stand up.
And just
there's no fun to be had.
Like his jokes. If listen back to that, I called it as he was saying those
you
fucking
did.
Names.
You said it right before.
And I haven't
you
heard this shit before.
You knew what he was gonna say.
Even his bullshit's as predictable as his fucking jokes.
Speaking of predictable jokes,
Jesus.
Listen to this
Christ.
Observation because I was just at the grocery store today. By the way, this is one of my pet peeves with comedians.
Yeah.
Sorry, Vinny. But the you know what I was doing today? Were ya? You do that every Thursday, Saturday, and Friday? All right.
I was grocery shopping today, and I was walking down the cereal aisle, and I saw a box of Life cereal. Someone had taken a permanent marker, and under the word Life, they'd written, sucks. I was driving here.
Dude, Vic Henley called from the grave and asked for his joke back. That's a Vic Henley joke. I saw a thing that was written on another thing.
This is my biggest issue about this guy. He sees Life cereal and he thinks, what if somebody wrote sucks underneath that? Which is something that anyone would think of, probably most people. And you would just immediately go, well, that's not very funny. What I like about good comedians is they come up with jokes you never would have come up with. And you go, oh, fuck. Or musicians. You're like, oh, that's so clever. That's so well done. I never would have come up with that. This guy goes, yeah, there's a pretty shitty neighborhood that I'm in. I went to the grocery store. Somebody wrote, sucks on Life cereal.
Yeah. Okay, great.
Yeah.
Well, he did sure. come up with a joke that no one I know would ever come up with.
Okay.
Here's number 14.
Okay.
but I have to get my hair cut. I have to get a cut because if I don't, it gets too long. And then I start to shed. And then whenever I clean out my shower drain, I feel like Jenny McCarthy's gynecologist.
What does he think a gynecologist does? That's a real question. Like, I want to know. What do you think goes on in that room, Tom Myers? You think they pull clumps of hair out of women's vagina? Is that what you think? Is that what you think a gynecologist does?
He really is mad.
I want to know. I really want to know the answer to this question. What the fuck kind of joke is that?
Yeah.
All right. Sorry, carry on. Go ahead.
So, right before that joke, he talks about getting his hair cut, and he's got a great joke for that.
I thought about getting a haircut before I came out here tonight, but I don't like getting my hair cut because I'm always worried they're going to get it cut too short. And then if I get it cut too short, you're going to look at me and be like, Ellen DeGeneres has really let herself go.
So,
God, that's so bad.
It's terrible.
So fucking bad.
All right, well, Ellen DeGeneres has short hair, but the premise is something that no one can relate to.
Yeah.
Because he's like, I was going to get my hair cut, but I was afraid it would be cut too short. You just tell the barber what length you want it to be. Is anyone going to the barber like, oh, fuck, I hope he doesn't cut my hair too short? Like, I'll have a number two on the sides. Thanks.
Wow.
What's he talking about?
Yeah.
I was afraid you guys would think I was Ellen DeGeneres. Oh, no, we would never think that. She has funny jokes. Ellen DeGeneres is actually a decent stand-up.
Yeah.
You, sir, are a hack. You wish you were fucking Ellen DeGeneres.
Compared to Tom Myers, Ellen DeGeneres is Lenny Bruce and George Carlin.
That's actually true.
That's what I've come here to say. Well, so this dude, he has no fucking clue how life works.
No.
So I want to, if it's all right, I want to bring you through a couple clips.
Yeah, let's do it.
He doesn't know how social media works at all. And we're 15 years into the social media era. Here's number 11.
Basically, taking selfies is a way of saying, I tried to find somebody, anybody, another living organism to take my picture for me. And I failed quite miserably. So here's an entire Facebook album of photos of me looking like a fucking loser.
Dude, have you ever seen a selfie before? Ever? People spend hours posing for selfies to make them look like winners. People's selfies are them on the beach and them on the trail and them on a bike ride and them with groups of friends and then at concerts. Like, people's selfies, they spend a lot of fucking time on these days and they all look like fucking parties. Like, you don't see people's selfies. You're like, boy, what a loser. He couldn't find someone to take his own picture. Like, no, that's all social media. And we're, again, a decade and a half into that. This isn't a new fucking thing.
Yeah, when people take pictures of, like, their dinner, I don't jerk off to those. Selfies, different story.
Absolutely, especially if they're young. Oh, sorry. That was my Tom Myers show. So let's talk about Instagram. Here's number 12.
All right.
Iran has barred Instagram. You can't use Instagram in Iran anymore. Good. Finally, a place I can go where people aren't posting pictures of their food.
All right. If you don't want to see pictures of people's food, you don't open Instagram. You don't have to go to a place where Instagram is barred by law. Just don't pick up your phone.
Crozier.
And your problem is solved. What
Crozier.
The fuck are we? Does he not know how any of this works?
Crozier, the problem here is that you're living in reality. And I think that
because of that,
you can't relate to his comedy stylings.
And last one.
That's the problem.
Last one. Number 13 is about Facebook statuses.
Facebook does this thing before you enter a status. They always ask you what's on your mind. How many people take that literally and write a tumor?
Shut up! That's fucking awful. Like, what kind of joke is that? We're again, we're 15 years into that fucking what's on your mind question. What, who are these jokes for? What the fuck is going on here? It's like he's seen social media like in a movie or something, so he knows he's gotta tell a story about it, but he's never actually experienced it or understand it.
He has experienced it because him and I had a Twitter battle.
Oh,
which
boy.
Is why we're doing this right now. Fucking Tom Myers.
Oh my God.
Speaking of a guy who his premises, I don't even understand how some of the things he says could possibly be construed as a joke, except for the fact that he's a comedian talking into a microphone.
Yeah.
I'm at that age where if I get up in the morning and the first thing I do is take a solid shit, I know it's going to be a good day.
Again, he's like 35, 36 years old.
Yeah.
And if I can wake up in the morning and take a solid shit, like, okay. How was that a joke? Because the word shit was in it?
Yeah.
What's funny about that?
I know. It's one of those, like, you should probably take that up with your doctor or maybe get a nutritionist. I mean, you can take steps to improve.
Crush. But I'm at the age where if I sleep for 7.5 hours, I feel well rested.
Whoa! Dude, that's a hell of a zinger right there.
I mean, I did take his master class online, so I'm starting to work out some of my new material that I've come up with since I did that.
Dude, in the morning I'm drinking my cup of coffee and I don't vomit blood everywhere, I say good fucking day. See, again, you know what I'm saying?
Again, that's too funny.
Oh, damn.
See, that was actually bananas, which makes it a little bit funny. This is the most ridiculous thing that he starts off his show with. He wants to tell you a little bit about him.
A little bit about me. I'm 35 years old, and my girlfriend looks at my penis the same way a kid looks at snow, waiting to hear if school's going to be closed.
So a little bit about me, I'm 35 years old, had nothing to do with the setup that he then went into for his next joke.
Yeah, those are very disconnected.
Gross, a little bit about me. I play guitar in an instrumental rock band, and my wife's vagina smells like goats. What kind of premise, what kind of setup is that to a joke? It doesn't make any sense. I'm 35 years old and here's my penis joke.
Yeah.
Like, what? I thought the joke was going to be about your age. It had nothing to do with that.
Yeah.
He'll be able to use that setup no matter what his age is. Hey, a little bit about me. I'm 12 years old and my girlfriend.
Yeah,
That probably wouldn't work, actually, now I think about it. Oh, let's talk about more blowjob jokes.
Oh, boy.
But I love performing in small towns. I really do. The women in small towns give the best blowjobs, owing to the fact they don't have any teeth left. So.
Yup.
Wow.
I love the audience reactions to some of these. All of these jokes are so hack and so obvious. This is like his fourth comedy album, too.
Oh, are you serious?
Yeah. This is like the fourth thing he's put out. He's been doing this forever. All right, let's talk about Las Vegas, because I don't know if you know this, but he's performed in Vegas before.
Is that so?
Yeah, he talks about it.
Very first time I got the opportunity to do Las Vegas, which is a big deal if you're a comedian.
All right. He says doing Las Vegas is a big deal if you're a comedian. I would argue that Las Vegas is actually just a city, right? I've seen Jerry Seinfeld in Las Vegas. I've seen Ray Romano. I've been to Las Vegas about a dozen times.
Yeah,
I've seen a lot of great comedians there.
Humble brag.
But there's also a place called Jokesters on Fremont Street.
Yeah.
Where anybody could play. Like, you could literally walk in blackout drunk.
I saw a guy perform in front of there, actually. Homeless day.
That was Tom Myers.
Yeah.
I'm pretty sure.
That guy was funnier than Tom Myers. I'm not even kidding with
you. So he's all proud of himself because he's actually performed in Vegas, which is a big deal if you're a stand-up. For some reason, even though it's just a city. And then he explains when he's done this.
But I do Las Vegas a lot, and they always send me there in like July and August.
Yeah, that's called the off season. That's literally the off season.
Yeah.
You're going to a tourist spot at the time when there are no tourists there.
Yeah.
So congratulations. That's a big deal for you comedians to be in Las Vegas in August.
I played a great comedy club, but they only put me on at 6 a.m.
Right. Yeah, right.
Oh, okay. Yeah, great.
That's actually funny because CBGBs, when that was still around in New York City, they would have people play all day and all night.
Yeah.
And you'd be able to say like, oh yeah, my band played at CBGBs. Yeah. It was 11 a.m. on a Saturday.
Yeah.
Like, sweet. Good for you, buddy. So he talks about the fact that his manager, because his manager is the one booking him in Las Vegas, his manager had a little sit down with him and told him some very interesting information that I think he needs to hear.
Yeah.
But my agent gave me this the other day. He said, you know, Tom, the reason you have trouble getting booked in a lot of major comedy clubs is you don't know how to write jokes for the average American. You need to learn how to write jokes that relate to the average American. And I'll be honest, I can't write jokes that relate to the average American.
Yep. All right. Well, that sums up the comedy special for me.
Yeah.
I think he nailed it with that one. All right. I want to go back real quick to the Ed Schrader show. And he starts talking about, he's a big history buff.
What?
He starts talking about his favorite time in history.
When I was in school, I studied history. My favorite piece of history to study was the American Revolution. Why do I like studying the American Revolution? Well, I like it because, not because it's the laying of the foundations of democracy or how ordinary men can rise up to fight against the evils of tyranny. I like that people were able to grow an incredible amount of pot back then and get away with it. That's why I love studying the American Revolution. Yeah. All those who are really supporting me behind that are going, I'd applaud, I just don't feel like lifting my arms, dude.
I didn't do any editing to that. That's the actual reaction he got.
I want to fucking strangle this guy.
He thinks that stoners are so lazy they don't want to applaud something that they enjoy.
I've been
to fish concerts. That's just not true.
The setup to that joke was unfucking bearable.
So after he tells that joke and it flops, he looks back at Ed Schrader, and by the way, the host of this show, and it's like a shitty cable access show, but the host of the show has his head in his hands, and he's just like, oh my God, man. And he looks back to try to like, hey man, what's up with your audience kind of thing?
Yeah.
After that joke, stoners don't want to raise their hands up and applaud, right? Oh, he says God. This.
I'd applaud. I just don't feel like lifting my arms, dude. They don't like puns, I don't think. They don't like the pun. Okay.
Pun?
He thought that was a pun? This is a professional comedian who thought that was a pun.
Good
lord. This guy's so stupid.
Good lord.
I don't think he should be talking about politics.
And he prefaces it with the opening paragraph from Wikipedia page from the Revolutionary War. And
it's yes.
A joke that stoners can't applaud. All right.
So then he says that the founding fathers didn't smoke pot, and this is how he knows that.
Everyone smoked pot back then. Paul Revere would be galloping down the street like, think the British are coming, dudes. Luckily for me, I got enough. I can share. You guys have been a great crowd. That's my time. Thank you very much. Thank you.
That was his closer?
That was his closer. All right.
Fuck
so
this guy.
Let's talk about that real quick. Yeah. He starts off by saying, my favorite time in history was the Revolutionary War because back then you could grow pot and no one would stop you. But the founding fathers who fought that war didn't smoke pot. And here's how I know, because then they'd be too burned out to fight the war. Like so you shit on your own point. And shitting on your own point has brought us to nowhere.
Yeah, it's just, you got to follow him. You got to hold this guy's hand the wrong way to get to that. And then there's no reward. There's no candy in this guy's van. You know what I'm saying?
And then he, in his Make America Innate Again special, he brags about how many jokes he writes.
I wrote over 2,000 jokes last calendar year.
Bullshit! Ain't no fat chicken.
I wrote over 2,000 jokes. I don't think he's written a single joke. And besides, I don't know that that matters. Like, most comedians don't measure their worth by the number of jokes they've written. They might look at things like, I don't know, people who attend their shows or money they've made from comedy. This guy thinks he's so impressive because he's written down these quips on a piece of paper and then recited them to people who get angrier and angrier the longer he's on stage.
Yeah, I mean, it's the Seamus mentality. It's quantity instead of quality. It's,
correct.
I've done 5,000 podcasts. They must be good. Like, no, you've done 5,000 shitty podcasts. This guy's written 2,000 fucking awful jokes that are, they barely count as coherent thoughts, let alone jokes.
When he was on Twitter explaining that I don't have a job and I can't get a woman, and I haven't accomplished anything in life, he said, and I've been in 30 states, Canada, and D.C. doing comedy.
Wow.
And that's not an accomplishment if you get booed off the stage everywhere you go.
Yeah, no shit. If this is the audience you've built after a decade on the circuit, and you're fucking, they can't even cheer you in your own recording session? What the fuck are you doing?
The only thing he said that's true is this.
You know, Tom, there's 100,000 people listening to you right now, and they all fucking hate your guts right now. Nope. Yes, you know it's true.
Yeah, there was a few like self-aware moments there. My number 22 had a couple of those.
He's very hateable.
I get those reactions a lot whenever I perform these jokes. Nobody in the studio fucking laughed at that one.
Yeah, it's like, and then there's like number 23 goes off on one.
That's a joke, obviously. That's a joke.
If you went to a coffee house, there's an acoustic guy playing, and he ends, and he's like, hey, that's a song, guys.
That was a song.
That was a song that I just played. You'd be like, let's get the fuck out of here. And that's exactly what I think of his comedy. It's fucking atrocious.
That was just a song. I don't really think we don't need no education. Lest anybody feel it. I was being legit about that.
I feel that we're more than dust in the wind.
So, all right. He's in Las Vegas now. Let's bring it back to Vegas real quick. And
okay.
And then we'll move on from there. And you know what happens in Vegas a lot, Crows? You ever been to Vegas before?
I have.
Yeah. You know what you see there all the time? I've been there like a dozen times. Elvis impersonators.
Yeah.
Right? Because it's still the 70s and 80s.
Of course.
Of course.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of Elvis impersonators out in Las Vegas. And some of them are good. Some of them are really bad. There's some Elvis impersonators out there that were so bad. I'm convinced they're doing their impersonation of Elvis a few hours before his death.
And then he moved on. That's after that.
Painfully
so didn't
unfunny.
That seem like a setup to like either an impression or a punchline? These Elvis impersonators, it's like an hour before his death, and then you'd like do something.
Yeah.
He had nothing.
Yeah.
He literally says that and then goes.
It's crazy. There's a bunch of things on here where there's a joke with no joke. There's right. No fucking joke.
There's a lot of those. There's 2,000 of them.
Yeah, 2,000 of them. Yeah, here's number 5.
Right. No, if you're anything like me, you don't want to like get out of the shower in a hotel room when they have one of those full-length mirrors, because then you notice everything starts to jiggle, and you look like one of those hospital Jell-O molds that they pulled right out of the fridge.
You look in the mirror, and it jiggles, and it looks like Jell-O. Dude, throw in a Bill Cosby impression or something. Do something, man. That's not even a fucking joke. Here's number 6.
You know what? It's funny you say that because it's almost as if he was given the premises and had to come up with a joke. He's like, guys, what am I supposed to do with that?
Yeah.
My body's jiggling. I had nothing. He's like, yeah, but you came up with the premise.
Yeah.
You didn't have to make a joke out of that if you couldn't. Oh. No one's making you.
But the very first time, I was an extra on House of Cards. I played a congressman. I was 29 years old, and it was a big deal. Little did I realize that if I was half that age, I would be Kevin Spacey's type.
I mean, what kind of joke is that?
Kevin Spacey fucks children.
And that's even a premise. You could go somewhere with that premise. But like, hey, I met him. But I wasn't 13, otherwise you would have fucked me. Ha ha ha. Like, no, that's not, that doesn't, that doesn't, what
can
are
I
you
point out?
Here,
can
man?
I point out the other part of that setup that I think is fascinating? I was an extra on House of Cards. It was a big deal.
Because he can't
stop himself from being like, look at how famous I am. Look at how well I'm doing. Like, dude, you were an extra. You live in the town where they shoot it.
Yeah.
You showed up to the set, and they're like, yeah, yeah, stand over there.
Yeah, they show the back of your head on TV for a fifth of a second on Netflix.
Why do they feel compelled to say that was a big deal?
Dude, if nothing else, say I was on House of Cards. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, don't even say you were an extra.
Don't even be like, I'm an extra. Like,
I played a congressman on House of Cards. Don't say it was a big deal. Don't say extra. We wouldn't be talking about this right now.
Oh, what the fuck? And this one is like, I mean, holy shit. Here's number 7.
Okay.
There were some people in Virginia who wanted to break away and go back with the Union. So they broke away and formed West Virginia and joined with the Union. So the good people of the state of West Virginia didn't want to be known as a bunch of backwoods, inbred, redneck racists. Oh, the fucking irony.
And that's the full setup. That's the full punchline. The his whole history lesson's in there. I guess it's really important, this fucking idiot. And the whole joke is like, hey, these people are from the South. Boy, are they stupid. Oh, it's like a fucking Vic Henley joke. Like, boy, people are South. They sure are stupid. Wow, you're breaking some new fucking ground there, buddy. Holy shit.
So Vic Henley isn't as fresh in my mind
as
Tom Myers.
Yeah,
is.
He's really hung with me, Carl, as you can tell.
I almost feel like Vic Henley's a better stand-up. Is that possible?
Right. So I was saying this to Chris.
Tell me
if you agree, okay? You're going to play a CD for someone that speaks no English. They speak French or whatever.
Okay.
You're playing the Vic Henley CD, and he's got his voice rises and falls, and the crowd responds, and he sounds like
a stand-up.
His material is garbage.
It's terrible.
But
he's got the right rhythm.
And he's got a confidence and a swagger, and he's very relaxed. Tom Myers sounds like a fucking asshole.
All right, here's a fun setup here, Croge.
Yeah.
He's talking about there's a police department that has its own Twitter account. And he explains what types of tweets are coming out from the police department's Twitter account. I'll play it for you, and then I have a very specific criticism for this.
Man shot twice in the chest on Harford Road. OMG.
All right, that would make sense. OMG, someone was shot. Like, that's a bad thing, right?
Homicide detectives arrive on scene, laugh out loud.
That makes no sense.
Yeah.
Homicide detectives arrive on scene, laugh out loud. Why? What's funny about that?
No witnesses reported. Sad face.
All right. That one makes sense. So he's structuring this wrong. If anything, you would end with the laugh out loud gag to be like, oh, the last one doesn't even.
Yeah. But I mean, that what he's saying is how teenagers texted in 2005. That's not how, anyone tweets.
That's a good point. All right, this is another premise that is so ridiculous. He's explaining, and the setup to this is a lot of people get pregnant around Christmas time.
Sure.
Because I guess couples are trying to get pregnant around Christmas time. I haven't experienced this in my life. Maybe it's true. So his joke is that, you know, people are having so much sex that the reason why you put ornaments on a tree is to cover up the cum stains. All right, hold on. Let me just play this clip.
I have a theory. That's why they have all those Christmas tree decorations around. They're hiding all the cum stains where they went ahead and made love. The neighbors come over. I didn't know you were into train sets. Oh, I'm not. That's where we made love right there earlier. Yeah.
So that's one of the rare occasions where he actually continues with the premise.
Yeah.
And has a second joke. But what's weird about that is he goes, you know, they want to cover up the cum stains, so they put ornaments on. And then the neighbors come over, like, oh, I didn't know you had a train set. He's like, no, I'm just covering up the cum stain. Then why put out the train set if you're just going to tell people?
Yeah.
Like, isn't that the whole point? Is that you're embarrassed that you're jizzing all over your house and you're trying to cover it up? Isn't that the point of the ornaments in the first place? According to his premise.
Yeah.
That's the point of the ornaments in the first place. Am I overthinking this?
And this might be a weird question, but how does he make love? That there's cum stains on the tree. You know what I'm saying?
No wonder he's never knocked anyone up. Like, that's not how you get pregnant.
Yeah.
You're shooting it all over a tree.
I feel like either I'm doing things wrong or he's doing things wrong. And I got two kids, so I don't know. I'm just saying.
Why can't you both be wrong?
Well, yeah, I guess. Well, yeah.
All right.
You know, are we winding down here on this guy?
I think we can wind down, yeah.
Because I wanted to talk about his closing bit.
Me too.
His closing bit is the only time that he does an extended bit.
Okay.
And so I broke it into two clips, and they suck, but I mean, this is his extended bit. This is the one thing that he's crafted that takes you on a journey through his mind into his comedic genius, you know?
Okay.
So here's closing bit part one. Here's number 26.
Oh, yeah, I know. As soon as I get home, my cat, just like a man, is going to be sacked out on my couch in front of my TV going, hey, what's up? You know my food dish is empty? My goddamn food dish is empty? And have you seen the state of my litter box? I know you don't clean your bathroom. I know because I tried to use yours. But I'm serious. Clean out my litter box, all right? Refill my food dish. I'm going to sit here and watch television. No, I'm not changing the channel either. Well, I don't have thumbs. I can't. So. No, I'm not watching Animal Planet, you dork. I'm watching my favorite movie of all time, Old Yeller.
Now, we just got like 45 seconds of the first-person voice of his cat. If you've ever been to anyone's house throughout your entire life, whether you're a little kid, you're an adult, wherever, and you go to someone's house and they have an animal, within 8 minutes, they will do their animal's voice for you. And they will say something like, hey, look at me, I need to be pet, or hey, I'm hungry, or whatever. Like, everyone does that who has a pet. And that's the that's his one bit. His one extended bit is here's what my cat thinks. And then he says a bunch of super fucking generic shit about being a cat.
Right.
There wasn't even a joke in there.
No, there wasn't even a joke
and
in there.
And he finally gets to a joke, and then this is his fucking, this is the pebble that's going to be the snowball. This is going to close the show. So we got to that. So if you're just joining us, his cat likes to watch Old Yeller. And now he's going to fucking fill you in, just in case you missed it, because I know it's real fucking subtle. So here's number 27.
That's where my cat and I have a lot in common. We both love watching movies where things we detest die. He loves watching the movie Old Yeller because of what happens to the dog. And I love watching the movie Titanic so I can watch Leonardo DiCaprio drown. Haverty Grace, it's been a pleasure spending time with you. Thank you guys for coming out.
That's your fucking closer?
Closers. Leonardo DiCaprio drown.
It doesn't even make any sense. And Wiley, what did Leo do to deserve this? He's super talented. Oh, he's a nice guy. What the fuck?
All right.
Why can't we watch Axl Rose drown? Why does it gotta be Leo?
Is there a movie where Axl Rose drowns?
I fucking wish there was. I would watch it. And I know this is going to sound crazy, but so I'm talking to Doug White, Doug from the Jingles Department, and he gave me Lars Ulrich's dad's phone number. So I call him up.
Oh.
I played him some of this special, and this is what he said, number 28.
I would say, delete that.
Is that from Some Kind of Monster? It's fucking hilarious.
They fucking play his dad the music, and his dad's like, I would delete that.
That's fantastic. So right before he talks about what his cat tells him when he gets home.
Yeah.
He says something, Crozier, and I saved this till the end of our Tom Myers bit because what's going to happen here is we're all going to feel bad that we made fun of Tom Myers for the last hour. This is the most pathetic thing I've ever heard somebody utter. And he says it on stage and then puts it on his comedy album and then promotes this comedy album for all of us to hear this.
I enjoy coming out performing for you guys. I really do. But one of the things I really enjoy doing is I enjoy going home, having some time to myself. I enjoy going home to my cat. I love my cat. He's my best buddy. He really is. And
when he said, my cat is my best buddy, he really is, I'm not kidding.
Yeah.
I got sad. And I went, oh, this guy's a pathetic loser with no friends.
Yeah, could you imagine another human being spending time around this guy on purpose?
You know that joke about his girlfriend looking to see if his penis is going to be 6 inches?
Yeah.
I don't think that's a real person. I don't even think he has a girlfriend. I think he just lives at home with his cat.
Yeah.
I think that's all that's going on there.
And we have reason to believe he doesn't know how people talk to each other, how social media works, how a vagina works, how lovemaking works. Like, he has no clue about any of this stuff. There's some real high-level autism going on here.
Croce, would you ever get up on stage? I know you've been on stage many times with a microphone in front of you.
Oh, boy.
A lot of bad things could happen.
Oh, yeah.
Would you ever get up there and talk about how your cat's your little buddy?
I can't even imagine. I can't even
imagine. What a fucking pathetic loser.
That's wild. Yeah.
Even Senator John would think this guy's a loser.
Yeah.
Oh, wait. Senator John thinks everyone's a loser. Well, that's right. Hey, when he was on that 2ABC Midday News show, he wanted to explain what's on this comedy album. So now that we know what's on the comedy album, let's hear how he explains it.
So what are people signing up for if they get your newest CD, Make America Innate Again?
They're pretty much getting, like you said, I cover all topics. If you're fans of, for example, if you're a fan of Donald Trump, I'll say some stuff on here that I'll joke about him. Likewise, I joke about stuff about the Democrats. I talk about, you know, current events, even my life on here. Even my cat's not safe.
Your cat?
No.
Oh my goodness.
That'll teach him to scratch my furniture.
He wasn't prepared for the question of, why should we buy your album? He's like, talk about Trump. There's a Democrat mentioned.
Yeah.
My cat. Like, holy shit, dude. You got to work on your sales pitch. The old elevator pitch, we like to call it.
Yeah.
12 seconds. Fuck. What do you got? Why am I buying this?
Oh.
All right. Crows is at the end of his rope. I know you got a bunch of clips on here. Is there anything else that you want to play? Any of these quote unquote jokes.
Yeah, nothing that you wanted to hit. Nothing from our buddy Tom.
All right, you're good with Tom?
I am. Who are these podcasts? WATP. Who likes these podcasts?